Well, good evening and welcome to worship here at Lord of Life. I'm Pastor Joel, and it is my privilege and pleasure to welcome you wherever you are to worship here with Lord of Life this evening. A special word of welcome to those of you who are guests from around this community, around the country, or even around the world. This is a special Good Friday service as we ruminate and meditate on the seven last words of Jesus. And so as a way for you to set the environment where you find yourself tonight, I invite you to find a candle and light it. Feel free to turn off the lights in the room where you find yourself. If you've got a blanket or a prayer shawl, go ahead and wrap yourself in that. This is an important time of worship, and we're so glad that we can be together for this. A word of thanks to pastors Karen and Peter Geisendorfer Lindgren for sharing the reflections today during worship, for our music leaders Dana and Derek Craig and David Frank as well. Offering today, as always, will be received by text, online, or through the mail. And so you can go to lordoflife.org/give to give online. You can text to the number that is on the screen, or as always, you can mail your offering in to the church. With that, however, I invite you to stand wherever you find yourself as we enter this time of worship, and we gather together wherever we find ourselves in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And let's pray. Merciful God, your Son was lifted up on the cross to draw all people to himself. Grant that we may at all times find mercy in him, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And we sing.
Oh, The first word from the cross, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Last evening on Maundy Thursday, the famous words, on the night on which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, were spoken. And the great gift of love, the sacrament of Holy Communion, was instituted in the midst of a tragic betrayal by Judas, one of Jesus' own disciples. The remarkable thing is that even as he is about to be betrayed, Jesus can think of others. Even as he is about to be given up to his enemies, Jesus thinks not of himself, but of us. It is an amazing thing. But tonight's first word from the cross is even more amazing. Today he has not just been betrayed, but he is an innocent man about to be executed. And what is Jesus able to say? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. It is almost inconceivable that there could be a love so great, and yet, there it is. What are the limits of Jesus' forgiveness? There are none. What might we do that God could not forgive? Nothing. Even Caiaphas, who called for his death, even Judas, who betrayed him, even Peter, who denied him, even Pilate, who washed his hands of it all, even the soldiers who mocked him and spat on him and gambled for his clothes, even the executioners who nailed his hands and his feet to the cross, even us. For all of us, Jesus could say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do.
The second word from the cross, "Today you will be with me in paradise." To the repentant sinner 2,000 years ago, Jesus says, "Today you will be with me in paradise." To each of us repentant sinners in our day, Jesus also says, "You will be with me in paradise." What a gift and what a great comfort. We will spend eternity with our Lord. Now, we don't know all of the details of what that means, but we do know that it will be wonderful beyond our human comprehension. And we know that Jesus has prepared a place for us so that we have nothing to fear. And that means more than we can know. Jesus has gone before us. I remember years ago when I was pregnant with our first child. I was nervous about the labor and delivery and what it was all going to be like. I remember talking with women who had gone through childbirth before me and asking them what it was like. Those who had already experienced it told me that it was really hard work, but that when the labor is over, you have the most miraculous reward for all that you've gone through. They reassured me that I could do it. They had done it, and I could do it too. Hearing the testimony of other moms, I was able to be more relaxed and confident as I faced the unknown. On a much deeper level, Jesus offers us great security and confidence as we face the unknown experience of death. We don't know what to expect when we die and go to heaven, but we do know that Jesus has gone before us, and we know that Jesus will be there with us. Jesus has conquered death and prepared a place for each of us to live with him throughout a glorious eternity. The second word from the cross is filled with hope, love, and promise. Today, you will be with me in paradise.
The third word from the cross. Woman, behold your son, behold your mother. People need each other. Particularly at times of death and grief, we need each other. Even when it seems like nothing could possibly lessen our pain, those of us who are left behind at the death of a loved one can somehow find real comfort in sharing our grief with another person. Jesus wanted that kind of love and support for his own mother. And so as he hung dying on the cross, he invited John, the disciple whom he loved, he invited John to be a son to Mary, to cry with her, to grieve with her, to work through their pain together, and ultimately to continue a caring and supportive relationship into the future. The Bible tells us that from that moment on, John took Mary into his home and cared for her as if she was his own mother. And from that time on, Mary cared for John as her own son. In these dark and grief-filled days, as the number of COVID-19 deaths rise, as mothers lose their sons, and as sons lose their mothers, as we experience pain almost beyond words, we gaze at Jesus upon the cross, showing amazing compassion and awareness. Jesus leads his mother and friend to each other. And in so doing, he is leading us to each other 2,000 years later. Because in the face of the death and grief of these perilous days, we need each other. And that's what Jesus taught when he said, "Woman, behold your son, behold your mother."
The fourth word from the cross, My God, why have you forsaken me? These words of Jesus are the most tragic of the words that Jesus speaks from the cross. These are cold, dark words. They reveal the agony that Jesus was feeling, not only the physical agony, but the spiritual agony. Here on the cross, Jesus was taking on all of our sins. The definition of sin is anything that separates us from God. And so when Jesus was dying for our sins, he experienced the most devastating sense of being cut off from God that can ever be imagined. Jesus felt forsaken. Forsaken is a word so appalling and dreadful that other words fail to capture it. Forsaken denotes a sense of abandonment by the ones that have loved you the most. Our hearts are filled with despair for a wife forsaken by her husband, a teen forsaken by his friends, a child forsaken by her parents. But to be forsaken by God, that would be the most terrible calamity that could befall a person. And yet, that is what Jesus felt. God was not angry with Jesus as he hung on the cross, obedient unto death, for Jesus was there completely surrendering himself to the work that he had been given to do. And so as Jesus Christ took our place, suffered in our stead, he endured everything that our sins merited. Jesus was our sin bearer. Upon him, the sin of the whole world was laid. And because sin is separation from God, he felt the total desolation of being forsaken, even by God. The fourth word from the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me?
The fifth word from the cross, I thirst. What a basic human need thirst. In these two short words, I thirst, Jesus once again reaffirms that he is not only fully God, but he is fully human. Jesus understands firsthand what it means to be exhausted, what it means to be in pain, what it means to be thirsty. Jesus is human, excruciatingly human. When we hear these words, I thirst, coming from our beloved Savior, we may think, if only we had been there, if only we could have done something to ease his suffering. Lord, if only we could have offered you a cool drink of water to quench your thirst. But of course, we weren't there that fateful day in that awful place. We weren't there to quench our Lord's thirst. But we are here on this day. And Jesus has done a remarkable thing. He has given us an opportunity to quench his thirst, to ease his suffering, and to show our great love to him. In the 25th chapter of the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus tells us that when we care for those who are in need in this world, we are caring for him. When we give food to the hungry, when we give drink to the thirsty, when we welcome the stranger, when we care for the sick, when we visit the prisoner, when we do any of those things, we are doing them to Christ himself. That message of caring for others is going to be especially important in the difficult months ahead. It is a message that Jesus wanted us always to remember, and it is one of the reasons why his fifth word from the cross was, I thirst.
Behold the Lamb.
The sixth word from the cross, it is finished. Jesus Christ was able to say, "It is finished." In perfect obedience, I have done everything I set out to do. It is finished. I have accomplished the salvation that sinful humanity is unable to accomplish on their own. What Jesus did for us on the cross sealed our salvation for all eternity. There is nothing more that we have to do to add to what Jesus has already done. In fact, there's nothing more that we can do. The book of Hebrews in the New Testament highlights again and again the all-sufficiency of Jesus Christ to provide us with everything we need for salvation. I have been reading Hebrews, and chapter 9 and 10 speak so clearly to us of what Jesus did for us on the cross. And my Bible, like the Bibles that we have in our pews here at church, has section headings describing what we're about to read. And chapter 9 of Hebrews says, "Christ's sacrifice takes away sins." Followed by chapter 10, "Christ's sacrifice once for all." That is a description of "it is finished" in a nutshell. Jesus died on the cross to take away our sins, and his once and for all sacrifice is enough. It is enough. We don't have to. In fact, we cannot come up with things to add to what Jesus has already done to make ourselves worthy in God's eyes. We come to the cross on this Good Friday, not with hands filled with all of the positive stuff that we've said and done, not with hands filled with our perfect theology and our complete understanding of the Bible, not with hands filled, perhaps these days, that hold an unwavering and fearless outlook in the face of impending threat, or hands filled with whatever we think we might need to add to the mix. But rather, we come to the cross with empty hands. Empty hands, only able to receive the grace and the love and the forgiveness and the salvation that Jesus Christ has provided for us. It is finished. May we open our hands and our hearts and receive God's gift.
The seventh word from the cross. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. And now, it is the end. These final words are spoken right before Jesus breathes his last. Yet even in these final words, Jesus teaches us something. In this seventh word from the cross, Jesus teaches us how to die. Hanging on the cross, Jesus has shown his concern for others. He has felt forsaken even by God. He suffered, thirsted, reflected on a life that is soon finished. And now, at the last, he gives himself up to God. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. In other words, Father, I give myself to you. Father, I trust in your graciousness. Father, my soul is in your care. When you and I are face to face with death, we might remember these words. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. Into your hands, which cradled me in my baptism. Into your hands, which molded me in my youth. Into your hands, which guided me as an adult. Into your hands that saw me through the great pandemic. Into your hands, which now comfort me as I lay dying. At the last, let us trust and believe as Jesus did, in the loving, gentle, caring hands of our gracious Father. Let us, at the end, say with Jesus, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit.
And at this time, brothers and sisters, I invite you to pray with me what is known as the bidding prayer as we pray for the Holy Church throughout the world. Almighty and eternal God, you have shown your glory to all nations in Jesus Christ. By your Holy Spirit, guide the church and gather it throughout the world. Help it to persevere in faith. Proclaim your name and bring the good news of salvation in Christ to all people. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for all servants of the church and for all the people of God. Almighty and eternal God, your Spirit guides the church and makes it holy. Strengthen and uphold our bishops, pastors, other ministers, and lay leaders. Keep them in health and safety for the good of the church. And help each of us in our various vocations to do faithfully the work to which you have called us. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for those preparing for baptism. Almighty and eternal God, you continue to bless the church. Increase the faith and understanding of those preparing for baptism. Give them new birth as your children, and keep them in the faith and communion of your holy church. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for our sisters and brothers who share our faith in Jesus Christ. Almighty and eternal God, you give your church unity. Look with favor on all who follow Jesus, your Son. Make all the baptized one in the fullness of faith and keep us united in the fellowship of love. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for the Jewish people, the first to hear the word of God. Almighty and eternal God, long ago you gave your promise to Abraham and your teaching to Moses. Hear our prayers that the people you called and elected as your own may receive the fulfillment of the covenant's promises. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for those who do not share our faith in Jesus Christ. Almighty and eternal God, gather into your embrace all those who call out to you under different names. Bring an end to interreligious strife and make us more faithful witnesses of the love made known to us in your Son. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for those who do not believe in God. And eternal God, you created humanity so that all may long to know you and find peace in you. Grant that all may recognize the signs of your love and grace in the world and in the lives of Christians, and gladly acknowledge you as the one true God. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for God's creation. Almighty and eternal God, you are the creator of a magnificent universe. Hold all the worlds in the arms of your care and bring all things to fulfillment in you. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for those who serve in public office. Almighty and eternal God, you are the champion of the poor and oppressed. In your goodness, give wisdom to those in authority, so that all people may enjoy justice, peace, freedom, and a share in the goodness of your creation. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for those in need. Almighty and eternal God, you give strength to the weary and new courage to those who have lost heart. Heal the sick. Comfort the dying. Give safety to all whose work puts them in harm's way. Free those unjustly deprived of liberty, and deliver your world from falsehood, hunger, and disease. Hear the prayers of all who call on you in any trouble, that they may have the joy of receiving your help in their need. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Finally, let us pray for all those things for which our Lord would have us ask. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Sometimes.